to the first ever episode of the M&K Productions. I'm your host, Mac, joined here by my co-host, Kristin. How are you doing today, Kristin? Say hi to the folks at home.
Hello, this is our first ever episode of the M&K Productions Podcast. This is so exciting. How are you, Mac?
I can't complain. Crippling debt, but who cares?
This is a new journey for us.
Yeah, it is.
Still same old content. You know, nothing's going to change. I'm happy. I'm ready to go.
Only thing that's changing is that we have a buttload of new guests today for our special Oscar episodes. We're doing an Oscar panel, and we're joined here by guests of new and old. And I want to first introduce someone you may be even familiar with the podcast, who I started this almost 2 years ago, the one, the only, Jay Ridge Cinema, a.k.a. Jayson. Welcome back, Jayson. How are you doing?
I'm doing great. How are you?
Doing good. What have you been up to? Are you ready to talk about the Oscars?
Hell yeah.
And our next guest, he's also a recurring guest star. We haven't done his monthly corner in a while, but we promised him we're going to do it maybe end of this month. Who knows? It's our Blu-ray expert himself, Big Knack 007, a.k.a. Rob. Welcome back, Rob. It's been a while.
Oh, thank you. Thanks for having me, guys.
Next guest, our last guest, he was recently on the episode a couple weeks ago, and me and Kristin have had the opportunity to go on his show, Lost in the Wasteland. It's our Wastelander reviewer himself, Shane. Shane, welcome back to the show.
Thank you for having me. I'm excited.
All right.
Well, first of all, before we get started, I want to say congratulations to Shane because he just earned himself 300 subscribers.
All right, congrats.
How does it feel?
It only took 4.5 years, but we got there.
And that's exciting. Steady. That's what matters. You're getting there. We are still at a low amount, so just like anybody else. But it takes time. So.
Well, and the fact that I got up to 200 in January, so that other 100 kind of just magically appeared. So I think we're running with things a bit, so I'm excited.
Yeah, it's a good thing. So we are so happy to have a great panel. So like what we said, we're just going to do some Oscar specials, do our Oscar special nominee episode today. So we're going to go through most of the nominated films and nominated categories. So let's start with a category that I think will get most of us talking, and that is the category of Best Animated Feature Film.
Now, nominees are... We have Onward, the Pixar film, of course. Over the Moon, a Shaun the Sheep movie, Farmageddon. I had no idea it was nominated. Soul and Wolfwake Walkers. So, we have two Pixar movies. I don't think Onward's Pixar. I think that's just Disney. But, yeah,
no, shout out Pixar.
Okay, we got two Pixar movies, and we got a Shaun the Sheep movie. So, what do you guys think?
And a Netflix and an Apple TV Plus movie.
Okay.
I've seen three of these. I've yet to watch Over the Moon and Shaun the Sheep, which technically Shaun the Sheep came out in 2019, if I'm not wrong, right?
Yes, you're right.
Well, it released on Netflix in January 2020.
See, I didn't know that. But, you know, I was like expecting, you know, the Croods to be thrown in there or like the Willoughbys or Scoob. You know, but we got some other, I feel like, you know, it was like pretty standard for like Wolfwalkers and Onward and Soul to be nominated. Like those are like no surprises, but Shaun the Sheep I was not expecting to be nominated.
I was just gonna say I've seen all five of them, and to be perfectly honest, this is a pretty strong category for, you know, the kind of year that we just had. And Shaun the Sheep Farmageddon made my top 10, so I was ridiculously happy when it made it into the nominations, because I thought the Croods was getting nominated. But this is a really tough one for me, because I loved Soul, I loved Shaun the Sheep, and I loved Wolfwalkers. But definitely for me, I'm a huge fan of Cartoon Saloon, and I really want Wolfwalkers to win it. But Soul's winning.
I would have loved to see it go to Wolfwalkers. I think that film is stunning, and I saw that film pretty recently, and I still can't get over the animation I saw, and it feels like that old school animation vibe where it's so hand-drawn and feels like so experienced with this animation as opposed to Pixar. It just felt something about Wolfwalkers felt so traditional that I really enjoyed it. And I don't think we always get to see that from animation. We always get the digital style, but it would be nice to see, you know, Wolfwalkers take it home.
Rob, Jayson, what are your thoughts on this animated category?
Well, I've only seen Shaun the Sheep movie, Onward, and Soul, but I can pretty much, I really think this is Soul's one to win because it's won all the precursors. They love Pixar, and Soul's just a really fun movie. And yeah, I think it's Soul winning.
Dang. What about you, Rob?
Yeah, I've only seen the probably out of the five, Onward and Soul. But what I've seen, I don't like Soul is probably the favorite to win. But you know what? I kind of want Onward to win, believe it or not.
Really?
Did you enjoy Onward?
Yeah, I think I liked it a little bit more. Soul was great, you know, excellent, you know, animated film. But I kind of geared to Onward for some reason. You know, Tom Holland and Chris Pratt's voices were in the story. I just haven't felt it more heartfelt for me, and it just moved a little bit faster for me, and the pacing, I should say, for me. On that one, but Soul was very good. You know, the music, especially Jamie Foxx's you know, voice performance there too. But I'm gonna have to go with Onward with this.
Wow! So we have everyone else for Soul, or no? We got two for Soul, one for Onward, and then one for Wolfwalkers.
But yeah, I would say though it's gonna go to Soul. So take that back from me. But,
yeah, so I'm going to say Shaun the Sheep because here's the thing with my thing. Aardman Animation is pretty much, I say Aardman Animation is one of the most underrated animated studios like of all time. They made Wallace and Gromit, Chicken Run, freaking Flushed Away, which is a freaking, I don't care what I say, that's actually a great animated film. Hugh Jackman's magnum opus. So, and hey, you know, Early Man was it. Early Man wasn't bad in 2018. It was a little disappointing because it came out next to Black Panther, but Early Man wasn't that bad. So Aardman, I give them a shot. I think they might have like they might take this.
And the kind of build off of that. Oh, go ahead, Kristin.
Sorry, I don't mean to cut you off. I remember like back in like 2016, Shaun the Sheep was like nominated too.
Because like, it's the good. First one. It's so good. Like, that movie's actually, like, I watched the shorts as a kid. I even watched the freaking, the baby spinoff they had on Playhouse Disney.
I remember that.
I was just going to shamelessly plug Cartoon Saloon after we shamelessly plugged Animation. Because if you love what you see with Wolfwalkers, go check out the Secret of Kells, Song of the Sea, and The Breadwinner. Because they make some great animation.
When you say Song of the Sea, I just keep thinking of Song of the South every time.
Oh, no, don't think about that.
I know, it's just so bad. It's like, oh, I'm like, oh, no.
No, Max, no.
But I've seen Song of the Sea, and I do enjoy it, because I think it was on Netflix for a little bit, and I watched it. I was like, this is really good.
Song of the South, you're not going to see that on Disney Plus, I can tell you that much.
All right, Kristin, what's the next category we're on to?
Let's move on to the category of Best Adapted Screenplay.
All right, and our nominees are Borat, the subsequent movie film, a.k.a. Borat 2, The Father, Nomadland, One Night in Miami, and The White Tiger. So I'm going to start off right here, Borat's winning, because it shocked at the Golden Globe for winning Best Drama and Best Comedy and Musical. It's going to take the Best Adapted Screenplay.
That's the one. Borat is the one film I feel like that shouldn't have won for like in any category. I don't understand why. I don't think it was that funny at all. It felt like this, like, you know, I come to the conclusion last night that I think Borat is like one of those YouTube prank videos, you know, where they like any second like Cody Pearson or somebody like really ridiculous on YouTube is going to jump out and say, it's just a prank, bro, you know?
Well, if you think about it, with the first Borat film, no one really knew about Sacha Baron Cohen. You had to be like, really like, hey, I follow his stuff. So it was easier to do some of this stuff. But if you make one in this day and age, everyone's like, okay, I know Borat, know what to expect. So we keep upping the ante, and some of it's going to seem fake than it was like real, like in the original one.
And I didn't think it was that funny to me. Like, I thought it was more shock value. I think that's what the full film was going for. And I just didn't think it sold it to me as much. I just thought it was okay.
Honestly, I thought it was hilarious, but this is just so weird seeing this nominated for an Oscar.
That's what also makes sense, too.
Two, I'm slightly disappointed we did not read its whole entire title. And you could also read off, like, the 9 writers on it, which is absolutely insane.
Writers. Everybody complains nowadays that, you know, a film gets a cluster mix when it has, like, 9 different writers on board. You know,
and yet, you could get nominated for an Oscar.
Yeah, and this is a film where it got nominated for an Oscar.
I'm happy The White Tiger got some recognition, because I think that was a really good film from Netflix. But, like, after seeing The Father, which blew me away, I want that to win. But I really do think, I think it would be nice to see One Night in Miami win this. Yeah. Because, let's be real here, this film is all writing. It's not like there's, like, action in this movie. It's basically a play. And if that writing didn't work, their dialogue didn't work, this movie wouldn't work. And it's a really moving film. So I think I'm going to put my bet on One Night in Miami and not be shocked if Borat somehow wins this.
I'm going to say the same thing, too. I would love to see One Night in Miami. And it was one of my favorite movies to come out last year. It's so beautiful how it's told. However, I'm surprised that Ma Rainey's Black Bottom didn't get nominated for adapted screenplay.
That was definitely The White Tiger kind of stole that one.
Definitely.
Now Borat stole it.
Borat stole it!
Well, here's the thing. I think we knew Borat was going to get nominated after all the other awards nominated it.
Rob, Jayson, what do you got in this category?
I think The Father has it. Because, like, ever since I saw it in October, I've been saying that, you know, it's a film that seems as though its visual presentation started in the script, like, has a very unique way of telling its story. And I feel like the Academy members would really like that. There's a lot of, you know, really great dialogue in it. So I think The Father's going to get it. I'd be surprised if Nomadland wins, though, because a lot of people seem to be predicting Nomadland for adapted screenplay, which I don't really agree with, because I feel like that film is more so about presentation than the writing. It's more so about the performance and the look and feel of the film. But, you know, it would be absolutely insane if Borat wins.
If Borat...
It would be insane.
If Borat wins, then, like, I think everyone who's, like the film snob be like, Borat winning is inconceivable.
But then they're like, screw Trump. Woo!
Yeah. What about you, Rob?
That's basically why this got nominated.
Yeah.
Yeah, it looks like The Father is a shoo-in on that one, probably. I heard, but... or No Man's Land, but... No, I've seen that halfway through, and Borat, I've seen the whole thing of that in its entirety. I'm gonna predict Nomadland on this one. I mean, I can see Chain saying about presentation, about performance, especially we're probably gonna get to that about Francis McDormand's performance. It's a performance-driven film, but. Yeah, I love Borat too for what it was, but it is so weird to see that nominee. You know, I don't know. You would think Ma Rainey's would take its place right there, but really shocked about that. I didn't see it on there, but yeah, I'm gonna go with No Man's Land. I think it kind of speaks out for what's going on too about people kind of like doing their own thing about, especially. what's going on with the pandemic. You know, you can't afford a rental to rent a place or even your mortgage. And, but one other option is, you know, either be on the streets or just hope you got a vehicle. You just want to just, see the world that way, in that view. So I'm going to go with Nomadland.
I have the book for Nomadland. I need to start reading it.
Didn't know there was a book.
Yeah, it was based on a book.
Oh, more you know, I guess.
Not going to lie, I usually get surprised when they announce the screenplay nominees every year because I'm like, oh, that was based off of something.
Yeah.
And that's usually how I find out.
Are any of you guys like the people who like to read the book and then see the movie, or like see the film, then read the book?
The only time I've done that was for Ready Player One, because I just wanted to see like if they screwed up anything, and then I watched the movie and I was like, yeah, it's fine. But I'm usually not like gung-ho about reading the book before.
I'm fine either way. Honestly, it really is what I come in, what I discover first, really. So.
Okay. Gotcha.
Yeah.
I always find that interesting when it comes to people, because I tend to do that a lot. Because the last book I did that for was Woman in the Window, whatever it is, the one with that Amy Adams is coming out in May on Netflix. Finally.
I forgot all about that movie. Holy crap.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Because Netflix bought it, right?
Yeah, it was supposed to come out last year, but the pandemic hit. But yeah, Netflix, it's going to be on Netflix.
Netflix is like mine now.
Yeah, they bought everything now, and especially knowing they just bought all the Knives Out movies
for $450 million.
That's like chunk change to Netflix at that point.
That is so odd. It's just like James Cameron making all these
Avatar sequels.
Yeah, it is. So
we don't need those.
To be fair, I'd much rather see a Knives Out sequel with Benoit Blanc than any more Avatar movies.
Listen,
everybody's been saying that.
Avatar, whenever Avatar 2, 3, and 4 comes out, it's going to shock the world. Like, everyone thought the first Avatar was going to be bad, made $1 billion. It's now the highest grossing movie again after it re-released in China. So it's gonna come back.
To be fair,
it's going to come out.
Box office doesn't always align with quality of a movie.
That is true.
Yes, we have seen that numerous times in the past.
Jayson, what did you say that one episode we did where we were talking about the Avatar sequels? You said that like it's not going to be good as the original.
Oh yeah, it's definitely not. I mean, when it came out, like the whole 3D and mocap craze was like new. Now it's like what can they possibly do to top it? Like
underwater.
Since we've had like all these different we've had bigger movies ever since it came out. Like, how can they do anything to top it, you know?
Fast and Furious in space.
Yeah, really? Yes. Honestly.
And outer space.
Oh my god, wait, one more thing before Avatar, before we go to the next category. Apparently, James Cameron said he almost fired the sequel writers when they were doing the movie. I was like, wow, you are very, like...
You don't say.
Your credibility has dropped. Like, if you think about it, he hasn't made a good movie since like Terminator 2, or no, Titanic, I'd say.
Well, to be fair, the only feature film that he's made since Titanic is Avatar.
Yeah,
that's true.
Put that in perspective.
Oh, James Cameron, where's our money? All right, what's the next category, Kristin?
All right, let's do best original screenplay.
All right, for the category, we got Judas and the Black Messiah, Minari. I hope I pronounced that right.
Minari.
Okay. Promising Young Woman, Sound of Metal, and The Trial of the Chicago 7. So this is a very interesting category because I like all these movies the same, but I just don't know which one it's going to go to.
Oh, for original screenplay, it's going to go to hands down Aaron Sorkin. Knowing that it won the Golden Globe and that it won last night for the SAG, I feel like this is like going to be the shoe-in to give it like all the Academy Awards that night, because this reminds me of the Spotlight situation that happened years ago.
What was that?
You don't remember Spotlight?
Nope.
Tom McCarthy film?
I certainly remember Spotlight.
What's your thoughts about Spotlight, Shane?
I have very strong feelings about Spotlight, because the fact that beat The Revenant and Mad Max Fury Road for Best Picture
made me
so mad.
Okay, right. To be fair, Shane, he's also a fellow New Jerseyan, Todd McCarthy. Mm-hmm. So you're not representing.
I'd rather be representing Down Under and supporting Mad Max for the best picture.
But I was going to say, Kristin, you are freaking the biggest vocal supporter for Promising Young Woman. You don't think that's going to win?
No, I don't think anything of Rush, the original screenplay category. As much as I want to, I would have loved to see it actually go to Minari or Promising Young Woman. But I know deep down, Aaron Sorkin is finally going to get his, like, Oscar.
I really want Promising Young Woman to win, but the trial of the Chicago 7 was too Aaron Sorkin-y for the Oscars to pass on. So I'm pretty sure Aaron Sorkin's going to win this.
Yeah, it's no given. I think it's going to win. Like, if it doesn't win that screenplay category, it's definitely going to win Best Picture. That's how I see it at this point.
I have some history on my side for thinking that Promising Young Woman is going to win.
Okay. Ooh, really? I want to hear this.
I want it to win because I love that movie and I think it's really, really well written and really confrontational and great. I think it's going to win because in 2017, there was a movie that won the Golden Globe for Best Screenplay and the SAG Award for Best Ensemble, three billboards, that lost original screenplay to a movie that won that won the Critics' Choice for Screenplay and the WGA Award. Get Out.
Wow.
Yeah.
We just got served a history lesson.
Yeah.
We did.
Yes.
So I really think that it's a three billboards Get Out situation, and I really think Promising Young Woman has it.
Maybe. Ooh, like it would be.
But I wouldn't be surprised if Sorkin wins. But I really hope I'm right about this.
Oh, I'm rooting for your answer. I want you to prove us all wrong here today.
What about you, Rob? What you got?
This is a pretty strong. Boy, this is a pretty strong. I have a hard time deciding. They're all subject matters. All these films are just so powerful, and each screenplay as well. What I've seen from the five was Judas and the Black Messiah and Minari. I'm gonna go with Judas and the Black Messiah.
Yes, my man Rob, because I was going to say this one thing. That movie is phenomenal.
Yeah, it was very, very good.
Just well written as well. It was just a powerful
movie.
Movie.
I like how each of these movies have a powerful message with each and every one of them. Like, there's a very heavy subject matter that involves each and every one of them. So it's interesting to see that. See more inclusivity with the Academy, you know.
Well, think about it. Judas and the Black Messiah can win because it's the most relevant film of the whole bunch.
That is very true.
And yeah, the Academy, the Academy is like, look at, we're relevant with the issues now. Wait, please, we're not racist, we swear.
Yes, give us pat on the back.
But what would be even more relevant for the Oscars would be to give it to a white guy for writing about those issues with the trial of the Chicago 7.
Yeah, really, honestly. Oh, dang. Let's move on to the next major category. Best Supporting Actress.
You go, because I cannot pronounce half of those names.
You cannot? Okay. We have Maria Bakalova from Borat and the subsequent movie film. Glenn Close in Hillbilly Elegy, Olivia Colman in The Father, Amanda Seyfried in Mank, and Yong Hoon Jun, I think that's how you say her name, in Minari.
After watching The Father, basically, I was absolutely blown away by Olivia Colman, and I really hope that she wins, but I'm thinking it looks like Yoo Jung-yeon from Minari is definitely getting some traction right now, so
yes.
I think she might win for this.
Yes!
I don't know. I feel like Olivia Colman, she's very, like, ever since she won for, what was that movie a few years back?
The Favorite.
The Favorite.
Yeah, ever since
The Favorite. That movie's outstanding, too.
She's been, like, on a, she's been a phoenix. She's just been like roaring past, like, oh, where have you come from? You're a great actress. Here's an award. Here, take this. So I feel like it's her, but I got a dark horse candidate. I feel like Amanda Seyfried might take this because she was, I loved her in Mank. I thought she was very, that's like one of the, her best well-rounded performances I've ever seen from her.
I can agree to that, and I think she gives the best performance out of everybody in that movie.
I wouldn't say that, but okay.
Really?
I think Gary Oldman did a great job.
He was good, but I feel like I enjoyed Seyfried a little bit more.
I think Mank has really cooled off, so I really don't know how many awards that's going to win.
Mm-hmm.
Honestly, right. At the Oscars this year.
I think that
there's a lot of momentum right now behind Yeon Yu Jung for Minari, and that film in general is just getting a lot of traction lately now that people are actually seeing it. Same thing with The Father. So I'm between Yeon Yu Jung and Olivia Colman. I really want Yeon Yu Jung to win because she is like the heart of that movie. So,
definitely, yeah. Jay, you just spoke. Took the words out of my mouth, and when she won last night for the Screen Actors Guild Awards, I was cheering my butt off. She deserved that Golden Globe a while back.
Right. Yeah.
And she was, like you said, the heart of the film, and I absolutely adored her, and I wish she was around in other movies that I saw, like, previously, because she's a talented actress.
Yeah, she really is.
So I'm rooting for her. I hope she wins it. But I do see a dark horse. Nobody has mentioned Glenn Close. Could this be the movie that the Golden Globes decide to... not Golden Globes. The Academy decide to give the award to in a... Not a great film.
God. Wait, please no.
Was Hillbilly... I didn't see it, but is Hillbilly Elegy not good?
Yeah, it is not good.
It's... I remember watching it, and I don't even remember how, if I didn't really like it. I don't even remember the grade I gave it. Honestly, I was like, well, Ron Howard tried.
Ron Howard? Oh, no.
Oh.
It's also funny how she's, how Glenn Close is nominated for a Razzie as well for the same performance.
She sure is.
Oh, I didn't know that.
She gets both awards in one weekend, just like the Sandra Bullock year.
Well, and here's the thing. I wish the Razzies were really the worst of the worst of film.
It's not.
Because, like, Glenn Close should not be nominated for a Razzie for this performance. She did her best in a not great movie, but, like, I can easily find you 5 supporting performances that are absolutely terrible from last year.
Oh, definitely.
Deserve to get nominated before that.
Razzies are about shock value. Let's be honest.
Yeah.
Where can we catch this movie with Glenn Close? Is it on Netflix still?
It's a Netflix original.
It's a Netflix original. It came out like in November, so around Thanksgiving time. And due to the bad rep it got, nobody really saw it. So
I remember seeing it. Yeah, I wasn't sure if it was Netflix or not.
Well, celebrate Thanksgiving. With some family dysfunction.
Yeah, honestly, nothing says like turkey and family happenings.
I do agree with, real quick, Shane, I do agree with you with the Razzies, because I love the Razzies, because I think they're, like, very funny to see what movies are like. Man, I do agree that's trash too, but they do kind of, like, some films and stuff they nominate, I'm like, really, was it that bad? Or did you guys just be like, hey, it just sucks, because So he's definitely getting, I'm just happy. I'm really happy he's getting this thing. Ugh, good times. But next category we have, we're into the meat and potatoes, guys. Are you guys ready?
All right.
Meat and potatoes, past the gravy.
Yep. We got best actress. We have Viola Davis for Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, Andra Day for The United States versus Billie Holiday, Vanessa Kirby for Pieces of a Woman, Frances McDormand for Nomadland, and Carey Mulligan for Promising Young Woman. And before this, I would like to say I fully apologize to Vanessa Kirby, because when I watched Hobbs and Shaw, I thought she was the worst actress I've ever seen in a Fast and Furious movie. But seeing her,
that's saying like, a lot.
Yeah. But seeing her in like Pieces of a Woman and the other films, I'm like, man, that just making me eat helpings of manure. Like, I apologize. She's a tremendous actress.
Wait, so you saw Pieces of a Woman now?
Yes, I have.
Yeah, isn't that great?
I loved it. But I do feel I feel like it's a toss-up between Viola Davis and Frances McDormand.
Yeah, knowing we saw last night's scenario, when it came down to it, I finally, like, when they were going to announce it, I thought it was going to go to Kirby or Mulligan. But seeing they gave it to Davis, I was very, very surprised. So now I think it's actually up in the air.
So, everyone else, what you got?
This is another tough category, because, like, here's the thing. Andra Day was so much better than the movie she was in, and that's tough to, like, separate that. And I was shocked when she won, because she won the Golden Globe, right?
Yeah, she did. Nobody wanted that to win, unfortunately, it won.
And then the four other ones are like, ugh, how do I pick from this?
Yeah, and, I, like, did not.
I would love to see Carey Mulligan win, because that was a dark and intense performance. But there's some heavy hitters here. You don't bet against Viola Davis and Frances McDormand. And I would not be shocked if what Nomadland winds up running away with is best actors for Frances McDormand. So I think that's going to win. Wouldn't be my first choice. But, you know, she's amazing. So I think she might win this one.
Definitely.
This is probably one of the toughest categories for me, because I really would love for Carey Mulligan to win. I would love for Vanessa Kirby to win. I would love for Frances McDormand to win. And I would love for Viola Davis to win. I haven't seen The United States versus Billie Holiday, but I think it's going to go to Viola Davis, because she really transforms in that movie. And yeah, it's a big showy performance. I wouldn't be surprised if it goes to Carey Mulligan. That performance is very, it's very layered. It's a real toss up. Like, I have no idea what's going to happen, especially since, you know, Viola Davis won the SAG Award last night. But yeah. I'm gonna go with Viola Davis. But I'd love for Carey Mulligan to win.
I did not like United States versus Billie Holiday. I thought it was overrated, honestly.
Yeah, I was really disappointed how it turned out. So, like I said earlier, I'm really hoping it could go to, honestly, any of the four except Andra Day.
Rob, who you got?
Yeah, judging from what I've seen, this is a hard one. But I'm going to narrow it down to Viola Davis or Frances McDormand. I'm going to have to... Yeah, I'm going to go with Viola Davis on this one. It's just by hair. That performance has a lot of really... how should I say? Just powerful. A lot of showmanship there on her part. The her singing or just giving it all, I thought. But in the flip side, Frances McDormand gives like a kind of like a real restraint performance, but it's kind of like a slow burn of a performance, yet it's just controlled too. And I'm just, Viola Davis just barely edges her up between those two, I think. So I'm going to give it to Viola Davis, I think. Hard decision.
I say, yeah, she's like, everyone is very, like, we don't know. This could go anyway, except for Andra Day. You don't deserve to win.
Yeah, honestly.
You really don't. But with the best actress, it's actually interesting to, like, switch over to the best actor, because I already know who's going to win Best Actor from Viola Davis's movie, but we're going to move on to Best Actor. We have Riz Ahmed from Sound of Metal, the late, great Chadwick Boseman from Ma Rainey's Black Bottom, Anthony Hopkins for The Father, Gary Oldman for Mank, and Stephen Young or Yang from Manera. So right off the bat, I'm going to just say this right now. Considering the late tragic passing of Chadwick Boseman and how he's won Golden Globes for Best Actor, he won the SAG Award for Best Actor, there's no doubt in my mind that they're just going to give him the Best Academy Award Actor.
Yeah, definitely. He really excelled in Ma Rainey's Black Bottom. It was an out-of-this-world performance he gave, and a heartbreaking last performance, you know. And it's sad to see him, like, have that film be his last role, because I think we could have gotten some more great performances out of him. Mm-hmm. But it's definitely going to go to Chadwick.
Yeah. It's not saying that, like, if he didn't pass away, like, they're going to give it, like, he could, if he was still alive, there wasn't a possibility that he would still be nominated, because he did give, like, a great performance.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Definitely.
Looking at this category, nothing against Gary Oldman and Mank, but if that was Delroy Lindo, this would be such an amazing lineup.
Yes. I know.
Oh, yeah.
And I really wish that he got nominated, but, like, Gary Oldman did a great job. It's Gary Oldman, but, like, what I remember about The Five Bloods was Delroy Lindo. But, like, looking at this, I remember watching Sound of Metal and being like, my God, Riz Ahmed should definitely be getting nominated for Best Actor. Chadwick Boseman, like, lit it up in Ma Rainey. Yeah. And Steven Yeun in Minari is fantastic. And having recently watched The Father, Anthony Hopkins totally emotionally devastated me. Mm-hmm. And I'm like, this is his best performance, honestly. And there is something.
Silence of the Lambs. Should I say that? Because he won an Oscar for that.
Well, he also won an Oscar for Best Actor for acting for 16 minutes in a movie. when he was nowhere near the main character of the movie. But, like, Anthony Hopkins is so amazing and has to do so much in that film. But Chadwick Boseman's winning this award. Like,
yeah,
hands down. I don't think there's, like, obviously, nothing's 100%. But, like, I would put down 99% that Chadwick Boseman's winning this award.
Yeah. Now that people are finally seeing The Father, it's, like, peaking at just the right time. Like, more and more people are seeing it, more and more people are loving it, and that's kind of giving it momentum. Mm-hmm. But I really think that it's going to go to Chadwick Boseman because, you know, it's a great performance, but also there's that element of he's gone way too soon. And, you know, it'll be really powerful to see his wife accept the Oscar for him. So I would keep an eye on Anthony Hopkins, but I do think it's going to go to Chadwick Boseman.
Rob?
Yeah.
What do you think?
Yeah, this one, also I want to mention Steven Yeun from Minari, first time that an Asian American's been nominated in this category.
Oh, yeah, breaking new ground.
You know, I just saw Ma Rainey just a couple hours ago.
Mm-hmm.
And, wow, Chadwick just acts his heart out in that and just gives a heartbreaking performance. It's going to, pound for pound, it's gonna have to go to Chadwick, I believe. And even you know, said that he's gone, this is his last role we're gonna see him in. But yeah, but him and Ma Rainey just stole the show, and a heartbreaking performance and a powerful one at that. And it just kind of edges out Steven Yeun's, even though a performance in Minari, that was like I said, it's kind of like the same kind of tone. Francis McDormand had in like Nomadland. It's kind of like real restraint kind of performance, but yet kind of like a slow burn kind of, but still gets to the finish line. But Chadwick was just kind of edges it out a little bit, so I'm gonna go with him.
So we all know who's going to win, but can we just have some respect for Riz Ahmed, how this man is probably, like, if he's a great actor.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. 100%.
So next category, we have Best Director. And we have Lee Isaac Chung from Minari.
Minari.
Emerald Fennell for Promising Young Woman. David Fincher for Mank. Thomas Vinterberg for Another Round, and Chloe Zhao from Nomadland.
Shane, so, I know I must say, Another Round is your movie. I know it's one of your top 10 favorites. You reviewed it in honor of the Golden Globe event that I got to host on my Instagram. So
that surprised the hell out of me when Vinterberg got nominated for Best Director, because I'm like, where's Sorkin? And he got nominated. I'm like, holy crap. And what the... So I know I already said that I wish Gary Oldman got replaced by Delroy Lindo. But the only way this would have gotten even better was if Mads Mikkelsen got nominated for Best Actor, too. But Thomas Vinterberg is an amazing director. If any of you haven't seen Another Round or The Hunt...
I like The Hunt.
Two amazing films, and I was so glad he got nominated over Aaron Sorkin, because, like, Sorkin knows how to write, and he does a fine job as a director, but I don't think he should have been nominated for Best Director for an Academy Award. And, like, you're looking at the rest of this, and, like, it's Fincher, so I was not surprised, and especially because it's very Hollywood, the film Mank, but the three other nominees... It's tough. I don't think Vinterberg's going to win. And I don't think Fincher's going to win.
I want Fincher to win. But I,
I really think Chloe Zhao's going to win
for Nomadland.
And boy, is that a beautiful film.
Mm-hmm.
And I think she's going to win. I do kind of want Emerald Fennell. Like, I kind of want the Promising Young Woman to win something. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to think what most likely award it would be to win, but I definitely think this is Chloe Zhao's to win.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. I could agree to that. I'm happy to see that two females are nominated in that category in itself. So I found that to be breaking new ground in the Best Director category. However, I see Zhao winning that because there was something special that she did, because she wrote the screenplay, she did the editing, and, you know, everything she did for herself was that for that film. So I think it's going to go to her overall work, and it's going to go to Zhao herself. So, because she did, like I said, everything. It says it, like, on the big, like, the last scene, written, directed, you know, all the shebang, you know, it's her. So you know, so I see it going, like, to her.
All the things.
Yes, essentially. She's like, I did everything by Zhao.
I'm very, very I love Aaron Sorkin, but I was ecstatic when Thomas Vinterberg got nominated for director over Sorkin, because, you know, I think that Sorkin's direction in Trial of the Chicago 7 was very bland. And, you know, I really love Another Round. Another Round is really... great film. I think it's gonna take best foreign language film, but, you know, I think it's Chloe Zhao's to win, because like you said, she wrote it, edited it. There's something about that film that it feels very personal to her, although, you know, I don't think she's had any of these experiences, but it just feels personal. It feels like a Chloe Zhao film. Mm-hmm. And, you know, there's, like, an sort of auteur stamp on it. I really think that it's going to go to Chloe Zhao. Although, again, keep an eye on Fincher, because he hasn't won anything and he's kind of due for an Oscar. So they might just throw him a bone this one time. Like, they might think that Chloe Zhao has, like, a couple other chances to win. But, you know, I think that Chloe Zhao is winning for director.
Mm-hmm. It'd be nice to see a female take it home, because the last time we saw a female director that at least I can remember see a female director taking it home was back when Catherine Bigelow won. And now they're starting to think it's now time, yeah, yet once again, for a female to take home that award if we're going to talk politics of
and
it.
She beat her ex-husband.
Yes, really? She did.
Ooh, and James Cameron for Avatar.
What's the best way to win an award?
Sticking it to the man.
Honestly, yeah. I don't like Catherine Bigelow.
What?
I think she's pretentious.
Really?
Because I did not like... Well, oh, she did Detroit, and I did not like Detroit because I felt like... Why are you doing this movie now? And I'm like, hey, it was like, you kind of seem like you're full of yourself, but Her Locker was good.
Her Locker was good, yeah. Her Locker was good.
Point Break was good, but you know, I don't like her.
Zero Dark Thirty is phenomenal.
Yeah.
She didn't do that, did she?
Yeah.
Yeah, she did.
Oh. I thought it was kind of bleh.
Check out Blue Steel with Jamie Lee Curtis. She directed that one too.
Oh yeah,
that's a good thriller. Clancy Brown's in there too. It's a good thriller.
All I know is Catherine Bigelow knows how to stress me out. Because watching The Hurt Locker stressed me out.
Yeah. Also, Near Dark,
and she did Strange Days with Ralph Fiennes, right?
Ralph Fiennes, yeah, and yeah, that's right. Angela Bassett was in there too, right?
Oh, mm-hmm. Dang.
Welcome to the Catherine Bigelow podcast.
Yeah, honestly, let's do that.
That was
Max. Like, that, no,
no,
no.
It's harder. I have to get a copy of Strange Days, but you can't find it.
All right, maybe
Craig. Yeah,
on board with that.
I love that movie.
Okay, on to the last category that we're gonna do. We have the whole kit and caboodle, Best Picture. And we have The Father, Judas and the Black Messiah, Mank, Minari, Nomadland, Promising Young Woman, Sound of Metal, and The Trial of the Chicago 7. So we've talked about a lot of these movies that have been nominated for different things. So everyone, what is the film that's going to take home the main prize? Like, what is it going to be?
I have a sinking feeling. This is going to be that award that the Trial of the Chicago 7 wins.
Yes. As much as I don't want it to go to Chicago 7, and even though, yeah, I still have yet to watch it, I don't want it to go to Trial Chicago 7. Like, my deep instincts are, like, making that, you know, that little emoji face where it's, like, makes that, like, narrow face where it's, like, no.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that unsatisfied face. Like, that's the face, like, I don't want it to go to. Like, I would like it to go to Nomadland or Promising Young Woman, but I doubt it's going to go to it. But I also have some hope that it could go to Minari. What about you guys?
I think... I think it might go to a Trial of the Chicago 7. I don't want it to. I love Aaron Sorkin, and I like the movie. It just seems like a very bland Best Picture winner. You know, if not Trial of Chicago 7, I'd say Nomadland, but I think that some people might find Nomadland too slow. With Promising Young Woman, I think that some people might not like Promising Young Woman. Promising Young Woman is very
controversial,
divisive. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's very divisive, very provocative. So I don't know how that will fare with the Academy members. So, but I'm gonna trust the precursors and say Nomadland. But like, it's like every day I'm changing my gold derby to either try the Chicago 7 or Nomadland. Like, I'm constantly changing it. So I'm gonna stick with Nomadland because it did win the precursor awards. It won the Golden Globe. It won the Critics' Choice. But Trial of the Chicago 7 would be kind of disappointing.
I was gonna ask, why are you guys so down on it a lot?
Well, like, my feeling is I really liked it a lot, but like, it just feels like a movie that would win Best Picture.
Okay.
And especially after such a bold pick with Parasite last year,
mm-hmm.
I just like, come on, think outside the box. But like, it's by Aaron Sorkin. It's a broad appeal film about racism and institutional racism with a big ensemble cast that's funny. So it cuts the edge, because like, most of these other films, I think probably the closest thing would be Mank. Mank seems like a film that would win Best Picture. It's about Hollywood. It's about Joseph Mankiewicz. It's like a legacy. It's like an old black and white style film. It just seems like something up the Academy's alley. But I feel like there's so many. This is a year where there weren't a whole lot of big films. So you have a lot of these smaller films making a bigger impact and getting a bigger spotlight that I just hope that they make the decision to give it to a film that's bold in how it deals with its subject matter and is impressive technically. Because, like, you can make that argument about The Father, Judas and the Black Messiah, Minari, Nomadland, Promising Young Woman, Sound of Metal. I just feel like I really liked Mank a lot. I think I liked Mank a lot more than a lot of people did. And I really enjoy The Trial of the Chicago 7. But I definitely agree with, like, The Trial of the Chicago 7 is a pretty bland, straightforward directed film. And I just hope that something more artistic and bold wins. But that's not always the Academy's MO. So we'll have to see. Because, like, was it the year before Parasite we got Green Book winning?
Yeah, yes.
It was Green Book.
It won that low-key. Like, this is, like, one of those times where we would have, like, another not-so-big, crazy movie that everybody's going to want to go see. And it's, you know,
they got to balance it out. So, Parasite last year, now they got to go save for this year.
Yeah,
I was going to say, Shane, do you think that the reason why you think The Trial of Chicago 7 might get it is because they played it safe with, like, hey, we'll give it to an international movie with Parasite, but then we're going to go back to the status quo a year later?
I think so, and I think that there's a lot of moving pieces in the Academy, because, like, there's, like, hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of people voting on these things, but it seems like there always seems to be some kind of balance. And I think The Trial of the Chicago 7, like, I don't know if it's 100% going to win. I just have a sinking feeling it's going to be one of those years where they go with a safer pick.
Exactly. Yeah.
I think Judas and the Black Messiah is going to win.
You think so?
Yeah, because it's like, it's out of all these movies, it's just the most relevant. And the Oscars likes to be relevant with the times. And they're like, you know what? We need a makeup movie for that one year where we didn't even nominate a single African-American movie. So I think this is an award. It speaks just with everything that's going on. And I think that, hey, it fits to what they would want to do to get the people watching again and talking about it. So this film.
And it's interesting that you bring up Judas and the Black Messiah, because it's basically the flip option of The Trial of the Chicago 7.
Honestly, I was just going to say the same thing. Yeah.
They deal with the same subject matters. They deal with the same relevant issues. It's just going to be, how bold do they want to go with it? Exactly. Because, like, Trial of Chicago 7 ends with, like, the happiest ending, I guess you could. Like, they stick it to the man, and they are all snarky and stuff, and, like, are still rebellious towards the judge and stuff like that. But, like, the end of Judas and the Black Messiah, there's no happy ending here.
No.
It's like, welcome to America.
Yeah.
Still the same thing. So I guess, and, like, in a year, if they were going to be really bold and wanted to go with something that really hit those issues with a raw and intense look, they would pick Judas and the Black Messiah.
Rob, but Jayson, what's your pick?
I think Jayson did say Trial Chicago 7 already, so, well,
I think Nomadland should, and I'm going to go with Nomadland, but Trial Chicago 7 would be very disappointing.
All right, Rob.
I'm gonna go with Mac to Judas and the Black Messiah.
Yeah,
it's just like so relevant and so powerful. And you got all those performance specials by Daniel Kaluuya and Lakeith Stanfield. With those guys, you can't. It's just so powerful, and we need to see something more like a powerful film like that. And
yeah,
I'm gonna go with that one, even though all these other ones are, you know, excellent choices, but yeah, but my second choice would be Trial of the Chicago 7 because it has Academy, you know, Oscar on it. You know what I mean? The staple of what should win a Academy Award, but my personal choice is going to be Judas and the Black Messiah.
One last thing before we wrap things up. I was surprised to see The Sound of Metal get recognized for Best Picture.
It's a good movie.
It's a great movie.
That made me happy.
Yes. I don't think a lot of people are expecting that, but I was happy to see it get some more recognition. And I'm very happy with some of these noms. So it's going to be a very interesting night, I think. It's going to be a lot of questions that I feel like I still don't know. It's obvious for some of the categories, but not obvious for most of them.
I just wish that Ben Affleck would have been nominated.
Oh, definitely.
Same. Yeah,
for The Way Back.
Yeah, what other movies did you guys wanted to see nominated?
I would have liked to see, I'm thinking of Ending Things, get at least a screenplay for, you know, adapted screenplay, but I understand why it's not nominated.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a little dirty out there.
Yeah.
I don't get how they pick the documentary nominees every year.
Yeah. Because
looking at, one, I'm so glad The Mole Agent got nominated, because if you haven't seen that, that's a beautiful, moving little film. But in what world does a movie about a guy and his love for an octopus get nominated over Boy State?
Yes! Yeah. I loved Boy State. That was the best documentary of the year, honestly.
So, I felt the same way about when Won't You Be My Neighbor didn't get nominated, that Mr. Rogers documentary, yeah, which was amazing, didn't get nominated.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah, excellent.
And this year, I saw My Octopus Teacher. It was fine. And I'm like, how the hell did this get nominated over Boy State? So honestly, out of snubs, Boy State for documentary probably is the biggest one for me that I wish got nominated.
Definitely. That was, I was expecting Boy State to be nominated, but knowing it didn't, I just was like, what? And then I kept hearing people talk about this octopus teacher and thought it was very weird. And I don't know all the hype of it. I just heard people talk about it. I have heard, like I said, mixed things, but
he felt too strongly about that octopus.
I feel like,
I was watching that movie and being like, this is a borderline inappropriate relationship with this octopus. I think you have too strong feelings for this. But one film that I wish, and I don't know exactly what I would have nominated for, I probably wish it would get nominated for cinematography, was First Cow. Because that got completely blown over when it came out towards the end of the summer last year, but even for cinematography, because I'm looking at some of the cinematography nominees. I'm like, The Trial of the Chicago 7?
Yeah.
Pieces of a Woman should have been nominated for cinematography, especially with that opening.
Basically, I think we could come up with dozens of nominees more deserving than The Trial of the Chicago 7.
Yeah, honestly.
But the other nominees, I can see.
Mm-hmm.
Which, right. News of the World, a really solid, well-done Western. I really enjoyed that movie.
Yeah, I was surprised to see Paul Greengrass was directing it and not seeing it nominated in more categories, especially for Tom Hanks.
I think people just take for granted that we're just going to get great Tom Hanks. It's interesting because you have the Tom Hankses where it's like, he's so great that you're just like, we don't need to nominate him. We just kind of forget about him. And then you have people like Meryl Streep, who's just so great that we're like, we need to nominate you for everything. Because Meryl Streep in a movie, nomination. Into the Woods, nomination.
Yeah, exactly.
The movie, not that she wasn't the best part of Into the Woods, but
the movie I think that definitely should have been nominated, and I don't know how you guys are going to feel about this, because I feel like we've all seen this movie, we've talked about it. I'm going to say Tenet for sound design, because the sound in Tenet was amazing, but I don't know why it got no love for at least that, in the award season. Like, I don't think it was nominated anyway. Well, I think the Golden Globe was nominated.
Visual effects.
Oh, yeah. But I just feel like it should have been nominated and win sound design, because I love the sound design in Tenet. The soundtrack's amazing. And
as long as we're not talking about the sound mixing.
Oh, no. Sound mixing was awful.
If sound was still two categories instead of just being one, I think we would have seen Tenet in a sound editing.
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't realize they combined them now.
Yeah, you didn't realize that?
Oh, that's why I couldn't find sound mixing on here. That was
one of the new rules that they decided to come up with.
Right. That's interesting, because I'm pretty sure that's why Tenet definitely didn't get nominated, though, right, if it's going to be the same award together. If Sound of Metal doesn't win that, I don't know what's wrong with people, because that whole entire movie was sound. Mm-hmm. But I definitely think Tenet could have, like, did it get a production design nominee?
Yes, it did. It did. Yeah, okay. Production design.
I think the only one that I feel like it kind of did got looked over for was maybe score.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. When's that the Academy's going to start nominating, like, stunt performance teams? I think, like, you know, that should be recognized and voice acting. Because
Tenet should win that 100%. Yeah. Unless
mocap. Performances.
Yeah, motion cap performances should be recognized, and voice acting should be recognized as well, too.
Well, they got that basis for that.
I think they should just call the motion cap award the Andy Serkis Award.
Yeah!
Oh, yeah!
Because it's like, there wouldn't be this if it wasn't for Andy Serkis.
The Andy Serkis Award goes to...
Or give the lifetime achievement to Andy Serkis Oscars,
too. I'll get that eventually.
So I do my own awards shows each year, and you know I nominated him for Best Actor for War for the Planet of the Apes, because, like, him as an ape made me feel things more than so many, like, actors in acting live did. I'm like, come on here.
So I think that's going to wrap up.
Yeah, this is going to wrap up our first episode. Sorry, I can't.
Our special Oscar episode. We had just a great panel. I want to thank you all for coming on, and we definitely got to do this again, because it was very fun to just get so many different views and just opinions on what this award show, because let's face it, this Academy Awards is probably going to be the most interesting Academy Awards of all time, because we had a pandemic going on. So
And they said no Zoom-in call, so if you're there or not, you accept the award. Oh, well.
I never got that because, you know, other people didn't show up for their awards before.
I was going to say, yeah. But, thank you all for coming on. And we're going to give you each an opportunity to tell the audience where they can find you, what you got coming up next. So, Shane, you're first up the bat. What have you got on tap for the Wasteland Reviewer?
Well, first off, thank you so much for having me. Yes. I always enjoy chatting movies with you both. In terms of what I have my YouTube channel, The Wasteland Reviewer YouTube channel, where I review tons and tons and tons of movies. I'm up to 161 from 2021 so far. I don't understand it.
Holy
I have
gosh.
A little podcast on there called Development Hell Podcast. I do my interview show, Lost in the Wasteland. So if anybody's interested in being interviewed about their movie perspectives, just let me know. And I'm doing a weekly show called Welcome to the Wasteland, where I dig deep into a particular film, which I think Kristin might be joining me at some point in the future.
Yes.
And I write for SifHop.com and Scribe Magazine, where I have my Wasteland Vintage Roadshow, where I write about classic reviews for films celebrating anniversaries. So that's been a fun thing. So shameless plugs all around, but thank you for having me.
No, you're allowed to do that. That's what we do here. We love some shameless plugs.
Rob, the freaking Blu-ray collector himself, we're going to get you on again in the new, like, really, really soon. But for the people at home, where can they find you at?
Well, thanks again for having me, Mac and Kristin. You could see my movie, part of my movie collection, movie-related content on my Instagram, which is on Big Knock 007. I'm mostly on there, so And then thanks again for having me. It was a blast.
We are so happy. You are like our friend to the show, and we always enjoy talking about your collections, and we can't wait to have you on again discussing more of your collection.
Yeah, and last but not least, Jayson, J-Bridge Cinema, man. Where can the people find you and what you got coming up? Because you see you've recently just posted a review of the Justice League movie on YouTube.
By the time this goes up, there will also be a review for Godzilla vs. Kong on my YouTube channel, Jayson Riddick. Jayson, R-I-D-I-K. You can also find me on Instagram at JRidCinema. All one word. And yeah, I'm going to be posting a lot more on YouTube in the coming future.
All right, perfect. You got everyone's links and everything. You're going to be down in the description below. So we want to thank you all for tuning in and listening. And leave in the comments below, what do you think is going to win these nominations or anything? We're very curious to hear. So this has been Mac, Kristin, Shane.
Follow us at on our Instagram pages, which will be in the link description below. If you're watching on YouTube or if you're listening on Spotify, please subscribe.
Yep. So
follow us.
Links for everybody is down in the description below. So this has been Mac, Kristin, Shane, Rob, and Jayson. And we'll see you guys on the next episode. Peace.
Of course, and I'm waving goodbye on an audio podcast.